The GATALIN trial was a randomized phase III trial comparing obinutuzumab and bendamustine versus bendamustine alone in patients who are known to be rituximab refractory with relapsed refractory follicular lymphoma. And the final analysis demonstrates that the original finding that the combination of obinutuzumab and bendamustine led to a marked improvement in outcome with about a 43% reduction in the risk of progression or death. And the overall survival benefit that was seen initially reported has been sustained over time. So clearly, the addition of obinutuzumab in this rituximab refractory combination really leads to an important improvement in survival in these patients who can be difficult to get into durable control.
At this year's ASH, the GATALIN data longer-term follow-up was presented. If you recall, this trial compared bendamustine alone versus bendamustine plus obinutuzumab in a relapsed refractory setting. Patients had to be refractory to rituximab to enroll in the study, and the updated data set suggests that the continued bendamustine and obinutuzumab is favorable over bendamustine alone. In terms of whether this changes practice, I think most of us would consider bendamustine alone as a suboptimal second-line regimen, but it does suggest that obinutuzumab combined with bendamustine does have a role in the second or later line setting. In terms of efficacy, it was about a doubling of progression-free survival, so bendamustine led to about a 13-month improvement in PFS versus about 24 months in the obinutuzumab-bendamustine arm. There was the toxicity that we typically would expect with a combined CD20 with bendamustine, including things like cytopenias, infections, but generally no increased signal or no new safety signals during the long-term follow-up. Bendamustine combined with obinutuzumab is clearly a reasonable choice for patients with advanced stage disease as long as they have a nice response to immunochemotherapy in the first line setting. This data just establishes, the updated data establishes that the PFS benefit continues with obinutuzumab compared to bendamustine alone, and there was no new safety signals of concern. And so it clearly is a reasonable choice, and this was a welcome update. There's been a number of recent investigations of combining obinutuzumab alongside novel therapies, including lenalidomide. So in the GALLAN study, which was a multicenter study out of Italy, patients in the relapsed refractory setting received obinutuzumab along with lenalidomide, initially at a lenalidomide dose of about 20 milligrams per day, 3 weeks out of four, for the first 6 months. Patients could then decrease their lenalidomide dose to about 10 milligrams for the remainder of another year and received obinutuzumab through the remainder of about 30 months. In the relapsed refractory setting, the combination of obinutuzumab and lenalidomide had good efficacy. There was progression-free survival of about 30 months, and the combination looked quite compelling. There were potential toxicities that we might expect combining obinutuzumab with lenalidomide, including things like cytopenias, some need of growth factor at some point, but generally was well tolerated and compares favorably to the rituximab and lenalidomide history. In terms of going forward, I think it'll be warranted to randomize this trial to have both a rituximab-containing arm with lenalidomide compared to obinutuzumab and lenalidomide to assess the true efficacy of the addition of obinutuzumab as well as the safety difference between these two new compounds. At this point, when I see a patient, I am typically using rituximab in the first-line setting. We've talked about the overall survival similarity between obinutuzumab and rituximab, and I often will think about using obinutuzumab in the second-line setting, whether it be combined with, say, bendamustine or combined with CHOP. That is typically where I'm using obinutuzumab, is in the second-line setting in someone that had progression beyond rituximab-containing immunochemotherapy.